And also from Fletcher House. We have some special guests this morning, and we want to get right to it. Diantha, would you introduce the bishop, please?
Hello? Hello? I'm happy to have my very good friend from Uganda with me, Bishop Tom Kiza. I live down the road from him, but we worked together at Mountains of the Moon University, where I was for 2 years, but he's also bishop of EOCC denomination, and I became his family took me in as a foreigner and the stranger in the land, which I was, and now we are no longer strangers. So I'll let him bring greetings and a little of what he's doing.
Praise the living Lord. Thank you so much, my sister and all the brothers present. We had a good time yesterday with the familiar faces now, both I think at the cell and then in the hall, the community hall. I was blessed, and I've been blessed to be part of this community. What a little paradise that is here. This is one of the best places I've visited in the world. My name is Kiza, from Western Uganda, towards the border with the Democratic Republic of Congo. I'm a bishop in the Ecumenical Orthodox Catholic Church. And I just walked, when I was walking in, I read, "May all be one." That is our mission, that is our vision. And so our vision and mission is blended with yours. And I'm at home to pray and worship with sisters and brothers. Our church seeks unity, peace with other Christians. And this is what you are doing. We are not only in mission, we are also in community development. So in my village, I have projects that are serving the people very close to the history of this area, how you began as a village and how you have grown. So I go home with the hope and the confidence that if you made it from the history I learned from the museum yesterday, my village will also be Pleasant Hill of Uganda. Amen? Because the history of this area, of this village, is exactly like the history of my village, and where we have begun and how you began is exactly what we are doing. We have a little school for the children. We have a health center, which is community-based for mothers and children. And then we have a skills or a trade training center. Isn't that how you began here in Pleasant Valley? Or Pleasant Hill? So, I have two things to say thank you, especially to the family of Diantha, the English, for welcoming me, and all the friends I've met. I worked in Mozambique, and I've met someone speaking Portuguese, so we are already discussing talking Portuguese. our Portuguese has come back, and we are now talking. We are not ending the talk. I want to thank you for opening the door to receive me and yesterday to allow me share our story. So I want to thank you, and I want to thank the American people. You are blessed. God has blessed you. We want a share of that blessing so that we can also bless and raise up our villages the other side. The second thing is I want to invite you to come to Uganda. Send us missionaries, send us young people, send us teams. Support us with your prayers. The work we are doing is so big. Uganda is 95% Christian. So anytime, anywhere, any corner you walk in, you will be welcomed. And Uganda is your home. Next time when I come, I'm sure I'll have more time so that I can see more families and more people. God bless you, and let us worship the Lord in truth and holiness. Thank you so much. Thank you, my sister.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Welcome home. If you were here.
I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, and I heard a voice saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. The Holy One will dwell with them, and they will be God's own peoples." The one in place of authority said, "See, I am making all things new. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw him. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As God has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails on his hands and put my finger in the mark of, of the nails on his side, I do not believe." A week later, the disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God."
Be with me. Come on. Hi, Nate. How you doing? Oh, yeah. Hi, Chloe. You can sit wherever you want. So, today we're talking about a man named Thomas, and he's called Doubting Thomas because he doubted. Tell me something. When your brother or sister tells you something, do you believe them? Do you? Yeah? I have a sister. I didn't believe her too much. Yeah. And that's okay. It's okay to doubt. How about when your parents tell you something? Do you believe that? Yeah, pretty much. You can kind of trust them. How about if I said I had something really, really precious in here? Would you believe me? One would. Maybe, maybe not. It's okay to doubt. And that's what we learn. Because Jesus responded to Thomas by just accepting that he doubted and showing him what he needed to see. And that's what I'd like you to take away today. Okay? Thanks for coming up. Yeah. Enjoy your time in Sunday school. You can take this along if you want to see what's in it. But you don't have to. I'll just leave it there.
I expected him to give me grief. Not as you might think for doubting. We had all doubted at different times, and he was never angry. Indeed, he doubted himself sometimes. Or if he didn't, he certainly understood how it felt, because he would sing the Psalms of doubt with great fervor. Doubt wasn't an enemy to him. He could stand us doubting. It was indifference he couldn't stand. Indifference and apathy. I expected him to give me grief, perhaps for making conditions. I did do that, and I won't deny it. If only I see this and do that, then I'll believe. Fancy me thinking I could make conditions with him. But he didn't take me to task. He saw that I was happy because I had seen. And he said that they were also happy who believed without making conditions, without saying, if only or unless. I expected him to give me grief because I wasn't there when he came. The others were present. I was absent. It wasn't their fault or his fault or mine. I had, for whatever reason, decided that it was all finished. He came back to say it was all beginning. I expected him to give me grief, but he didn't. He gave me his hand.
Peace be with you. So stop me if you've heard this one. There was this atheist who was walking in the woods. He was enjoying the majestic trees and the powerful rivers, beautiful animals. And as he continued to walk by the river, he heard a little rustling. And he turned, and he saw a 7-foot grizzly bear. Well, he started to run as fast as he could, but in the process of running, he tripped and he fell. And as he turned over, he saw this big grizzly bear with his paw up, ready to swipe. And the atheist forgot himself and said, "Oh my God." Time stopped. No sounds. Forest was silent, and a bright light shone. And a voice came out and said, "You deny my existence all this time, and now you want me to help you?" Uh-huh. Well, the atheist looked into the light and he said, "Okay, that would be hypocritical, but could you at least make the bear Christian?" The voice said, "All right." The light went out, sounds of the forest returned, and that bear that had his paw ready to swipe, he brought it down, and he said, "Lord, bless this food which I am about to receive, for which I am truly thankful." Yeah. Thomas was not an atheist. Thomas wasn't even an agnostic. The story of Thomas is just one of the ways in which we see a reaction to the resurrection. The gospel lesson today starts way back on the first Easter. According to John, Mary is in the garden and appears to Jesus. She sees and she believes. Peter and John, they run into the empty tomb. They see the burial cloth, the napkin folded. They see and they believe. Jesus appears to the 10 disciples who are in the room, all except Thomas. They see, they believe, but where was Thomas? Did he stop off at 7-Eleven for a Big Gulp on the way? Did he get caught in traffic? Who knows? He wasn't there, but imagine how it must have gone. Thomas, you're never going to believe this. And sure enough, he doesn't. He doubts. But is it doubt? No, it's not really doubt. Thomas puts a condition on his belief. If I see, I will believe. An absolute clear condition. And please notice that Thomas never asks for anything that all the others had not already had. Seeing and believing. Is it bothering anybody else what might be in there? Mm-hmm. Okay. Instead of thinking of Thomas as lacking because he's been characterized as doubting, perhaps we are misunderstanding the nature of faith altogether. Instead of thinking that the more faith we have, the fewer questions we should have, this scripture offers us a different picture of faith, one in which faith and doubt are intricately woven together. As you digest that, let's take a breath and let's look at who Thomas was. What do we know about him? Well, we gather information from a variety of sources, from the scripture, both canonical and apocryphal, from several of the Gnostic scrolls. There's a fourth century historian who mentions him. We can put together that Thomas was born in the first century. He preaches in Babylon and in Persia, and then he goes and sails south to the west side of India. He preaches there, and he establishes many churches. And in fact, in the 1600s, when the Portuguese arrive, there is a church there, Mar Thoma Church, that was established by Thomas. Then he goes to the other side of India and dies maybe around AD 72, near present-day Madras. But what was his name? Easy one, right? Thomas. No. Aramaic, the language of first century Israel. The Aramaic word for twin is Tama. The Greek word for twin is Didymus. And so when it's translated Thomas the twin, it's twin, the twin. It's very likely that Thomas is just a nickname. By translating Thomas to Didymus three times, this Gospel of John makes clear that as an adult, Thomas was simply known, even among Greek speakers, as the twin. So the question comes, of whom was he a twin? Who was so famous that this person was only called the twin? Well, some early Christian traditions suggest that Thomas was the twin of Jesus. There are a number of texts from 2nd and 3rd century that speak of an apostle named Judas Thomas Didymus. Judas, of course, not only the name of Jesus' betrayer, but one of his brothers, as we see in Matthew and Mark. Gospel of John refers to Judas, who is not Iscariot, and in one of the Syriac translations of the Gospel of John, Judas becomes Judas Thomas. So one interpretive possibility seized upon by some early Christian traditions and that I'd like you to consider today is that this apostle called twin is the brother, the twin of Jesus. In the Gospel of Thomas, it's written the secret words that the Savior spoke to Judas Thomas, and included is this statement. Now, since it has been said that you are my twin and true companion, examine yourself. Learn who you are, in what way you exist, and how you will come to be. Since you are called my brother, it is not fitting that you be ignorant of yourself. An invitation to doubt. Doubt is not the opposite of faith, but it is an essential ingredient in faith. It's a stop along the way, a stop that we make more than one time, a stop that some of us make regularly. And when we find ourselves there, it's a sign that we're actually taking our relationship with God seriously, seriously enough to be honest. We're letting ourselves start a journey that we don't know how exactly it will end. The twin was the one disciple, the one who had the courage to ask those awkward questions. He confessed his ignorance, and as a result, he became the first one to say, "My Lord and my God." Now, when we doubt, we don't always get there right away to that statement. Carl Rogers, psychologist in the U.S., he tells about the time in 1924. He was 22 years old, and he entered seminary up at Union Seminary in New York City. He took part in a seminar where they explored religious doubt. And this is what he says. The majority of members, in thinking their way through questions they had raised, thought themselves right out of religious work, and I was one. Well, that happens. Sometimes our doubt is that strong. And how does Jesus react? How did he react to the twin? From reading this gospel, we discover that Jesus shows us great compassion, even in our doubt, or perhaps especially in our doubt. It's significant that Jesus did not reject or even modify the twin's doubt, and instead, he nodded approvingly. It's a comfort to me that I don't always have to come around to the answers. My twin can bear that and simply love me no matter what. I was reading a story about a woman in her 30s. One day, she had an overwhelming experience, spiritual experience. She knew that God was present in those moments, and she knew that God was asking her to do something that was new, that was hard, it was scary. She felt it so much that she went ahead and did that. For over 50 years, she did that hard, scary thing. And it was amazing. But inside, she doubted. She wrestled with her faith and had long periods that we sometimes refer to as the dark night of the soul. Often she questioned the existence of God. You might call her Doubting Teresa. You know her as Mother Teresa. I used to see pictures of her and I think, oh, how self-assured, and she knows, she feels God. Wasn't the case. She doubted constantly. Just like us. Just like the twin. Doubt is a scary thing. We can even be ashamed of our doubt, and many of us struggle with doubt. A doubt that can choke the life out of us. And sometimes we fall into a pit of despair and we don't know how to climb out. We use books, we use logic, we look for evidence, but we get stuck in unbelief. We have many sleepless nights when our doubt drains us. In those moments, I would like you to remember the twin and picture the twin facing off with his brother, demanding to be shown and not being judged, but simply being loved. As we struggle with our own doubt and unbelief, we have the support of one another. And I can think of no better company to be in than this congregation. Our faith gets shaken. We question. We wonder why Jesus doesn't appear to us as it seems that he's appeared to everyone else around us. Doubt can be the thing that propels us to faith. It can be the thing that shakes us up. It can be what pushes us out of the doors, out of our once comfortable place and into a new and better world. It can be the ticket that starts our journey to a new life. It can be not the sign of an absence of God, but of God working within us to do something new. As Jesus met Thomas where he was without judgment, all of us, when our hearts fill with a fear that we can't get our arms around, a fear that makes us weak, feel inadequate, all of us disciples receive that same gift of grace and forgiveness and the Holy Spirit. A gift that limbers up our minds and our hearts, and that's why Jesus sends us out into the world, to put our hands on the marks of the suffering, to bring good news and hope to all of God's children. Isn't that why we come to church? We hope that we will experience as part of the community of faith. And isn't it the mission of the church to love the world, as Parker Palmer says, not to enlarge our membership, to love the world, not to bring ourselves to accept our terms, but to love the world in every possible way. To love the world as God did and does. Whatever doubts turn in your minds, have the comfort that you're in good company and that your twin comes to you and says, "Peace be with you." Amen.
What gift can we offer? What present? What token? What gifts can we convey the joy of this day? When grateful we come, remembering, rejoicing, what offering can we bring in honor and praise? Give thanks for the past, for those who had vision, who planted and watered so dreams come true. Give thanks for the known of study for worship, that mission that bids us to turn prayer into deed. Give thanks for tomorrow, full of surprises, for knowing whatever tomorrow may bring. Our gifts are our promises, always, forever. We rest in God's keeping and live in God's love. The gift we now bring, this present, this token, these words can convey it the joy of the day. When grateful we come, remembering, rejoicing, the gifts we now offer in honor and praise.
Receive the benediction and the postlude afterwards. I'm going to ask you to do something that we don't usually do, and that's take the hand of someone and feel the wounds and allow them to propel you as you go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all. Loving and serving God through the power of the Holy Spirit. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.